The show was considered a flop after the first 3 years, and we struggled to keep that thing on the air. But finally, when they put it in at Friday nights, I believe, at 10 p.m., Gene knew as soon as he got that message that it was a no-go.
That's very strange. I'm getting a feeling of anxiety.
We had gone down to Palm Springs, as a matter of fact, and he had taken 8 shows with him. And he said, I'm going to make this the best season that Star Trek ever had, and we're going to stay on forever.
The glorious victories.
Well, we no sooner get down there than he gets a call.
The glorious failures.
From NBC, who says, Gene, baby, well, at that point, you know you're in trouble. He says, we've got a great spot for you. We're going to change you. I guess it was from Monday or Tuesday at 8 p.m., which would have been perfect, of course, into Friday nights at 10 p.m.
It's to kill the pain.
And Gene, now that's just slightly better than 2 a.m. Sunday morning, for heaven's sakes. I mean, our people are out that night. They're young marrieds. They're college professors. They have been working all week. They don't stay home to watch a television show. The only person home on Friday nights at 10 p.m. is going to be Aunt Maud in Iowa. Now, she's not going to watch our show if we produce it for her live.
We would all be lost, forever lost.
It was just the terrible, terrible time slot. And Gene gave up. We picked up all the scripts like this, and home we came.
I went up to see Roddenberry with my agent, and we knew each other because we were both writers for Ziv. When we were, Ziv Studios was a big production outfit earlier. And we met there, so we knew each other pretty well. And he asked me if I wanted to do the show. And I said, yeah, I love what I'd seen, and I'd be very anxious to. So the deal was made where I came on as writer-producer.
Unquestionably, most impressive.
We had a big meeting with the network brass. There must have been about 20 network people. And I was there, of course, and Gene and Bob Justman. And I was astounded at seeming to me the mutual contempt the network and Roddenberry had for each other. It kind of shocked me.
A madman got us into this, and it's beginning to look as if only a madman can get us out.
Gene, he took me to show me my office, and I said, but this is your office. And he said, no, it's your office, because he had a commitment to another studio now, because the network was so late in picking up the show that Gene had no recourse but to seek other employment, and he had made another commitment. So he said he won't be physically around, but, you know, I'd be able to get in touch with him, of course, anytime I wanted to.
The universe will be mine to command, yours to play in.
Ratings were 25 to 20, share, between 25 to 28. Today, that's a smash hit. But in those days, 30, if you had a 30, you were on the edge. Doubtful whether to be picked up. But the fans were so vociferous and so loyal that they, in essence, forced the network to pick the show up again.
We did it by obtaining mailing lists from science fiction conventions and from very friendly catalog mail order dealers, and some help with stamps from all the fans that would send in sheets of stamps to us, and that was what happened.
But I was told that if the network's been improved, the show is going to be canceled.
You bring this network's ratings down, Flavius, and we'll do a special on you.
Actually, the whole thing was a great deflation. It was just, how could they possibly not know what a good show it was?
The glory of creation is in its infinite diversity.
I then had a meeting with the production department, and they informed us that the budget was being cut. Shatner and Nimoy were getting raises. Nobody else was.
Check.
Right.
Bob Justman, who was the line producer on the show, was very unhappy.
I was heartbroken. I felt as if I was in prison. We had been cut down so much by the studio with respect to our budget from an original 193.5 to 185 to 178.5, and we had no money.
I guess the studio figured they had to retrench in somehow or other, and that every fourth episode would have to be done on the Enterprise. Maybe a minimal set on one or two, but every fourth show had to be done entirely on the Enterprise.
We couldn't afford to go on location. We couldn't afford to write anything that was really as good as we would like. We were reduced to doing what I called a radio show, where people stood around and talked to each other.
I wish there were moonlight, too. Moonlight would suit you very well.
I see you're a very complicated man.
And I just couldn't abide it any longer, so I left.
I thought I'd take it as a challenge, you know, to do shows all on the Enterprise. And I thought we did pretty good in a lot of them. We did a show about Is There No Truth in Beauty?
Mark! No, look!
And I didn't feel that restrictions really hurt the shows in a case.